Homer and Classical Philology. By Friedrich Nietzsche. There is no unified and clearly recognizable public opinion about classical philology in our day. This is felt in the circles of the educated in general as in the midst of the disciples of that science itself. The cause lies in the multifaceted character of it, in the lack of a conceptual unity, in the inorganic aggregate state of various scientific activities which can only be identified by the name philology are tied together. One must honestly admit that philology is borrowed from several sciences to a certain extent and brewed like a magic potion from the most strange juices, metals and bones, yes that it also contains an artistic element that is imperative on aesthetic and ethical grounds, which is in serious conflict with their purely scientific behavior. It is just as much a piece of history as a piece of natural science as a piece of aesthetics, history insofar as it seeks to understand the manifestations of certain people's individualities in ever new images. The prevailing law in the flight of phenomena, natural science as far as it tries to understand the deepest human instinct tries to fathom the linguistic instinct, aesthetics, finally, because it sets up the so-called classical antiquity out of the series of antiquities, with the claim and the intention of obscuring one to dig out the ideal world and to hold the mirror of the classic and the eternally valid against the present. The fact that these thoroughly diverse scientific and aesthetic ethical instincts have come together under a common name, under a kind of pseudo-monarchy, is explained above all by the fact that philology, in its origin and at all times, has at the same time been pedagogy. From the pedagogical point of view, a selection of the most instructive and educational elements was required, and so, under the pressure of need, from a practical occupation, that science, or at least that scientific tendency, which we call philology, has developed. The various basic tendencies mentioned have now emerged in certain times, sometimes with more emphasis, sometimes with less emphasis, in connection with the degree of culture and the development of taste in the respective period, and in turn the individual representatives of that science always tend to understand the directions most appropriate to their ability and will as the central directions of philology, so that the appreciation of philology in public opinion is very dependent on the force of the philological personalities. In the present, that is, at a time which has experienced excellent natures in almost every possible direction of philology, a general uncertainty of judgment has prevailed, and at the same time a prevailing slackening of participation in philological problems. Such an undecided and half-state state of public opinion hits a science sensitively insofar as its open and secret enemies can work with much greater success. Philology, however, has a great abundance of such enemies. Where do you not meet them, the scoffers, who are always ready to strike the philological moles, the sex that engages in swallowing dust ex-professo, the clodhopper thrown up 10 times raises and ruffles for the 11th time. For this kind of opponent, however, philology is an admittedly useless, at least harmless and harmless pastime, an object of joke, not of hatred. On the other hand, a very fierce and irrepressible hatred of philology lives wherever the ideal as such is feared, where modern man falls down in happy admiration for himself, where Hellenism is regarded as a defeated and therefore very indifferent standpoint. In the face of these enemies, we philologists must always count on the support of artists and artistic natures, since they alone can feel how the sword of barbarism hovers over the head of every individual who loses sight of the unspeakable simplicity and noble dignity of the Hellenic, while philology as a whole is viewed curiously by the two classes of opponents mentioned. There are, on the other hand, numerous and extremely varied hostilities in certain branches of philology. Battles fought out by philologists against philologists, disputes of a purely domestic nature, caused by a useless dispute over rank and the mutual jealousy, but above all through the already emphasized difference, indeed hostility, of the basic instincts that are summarized under the name of philology, but not merged. What science has in common with art is that the most everyday things appear completely new and attractive, yes, as if through the power of an enchantment, as just born and now experienced for the first time. Life is worth living, says art, the most beautiful seductress, Life is worth knowing, says science. In this juxtaposition, the inner and often heart-rending contradiction in the term emerges, and accordingly in the activity of classical philology guided by this concept. If we place ourselves scientifically on antiquity, may we now try to understand what has become with the eye of the historian, or, in the manner of the natural scientist, categorize, compare the linguistic forms of ancient masterpieces, at best bring them back to a few morphological laws. We always lose what is wonderfully visual, yes, the actual scent of the ancient atmosphere. We forget that longing impulse which our senses and enjoyment with the power of instinct, as the loveliest charioteer, brought to the Greeks. From here, attention should be drawn to a very specific and at first very surprising antagonism, which philology always has to regret most. Namely, from those circles we must most surely count on their assistance, the artistic friends of antiquity, the warm admirers of Hellenic beauty and noble simplicity, sometimes out of tune tones, as if the philologists themselves were the real opponents and devastators of antiquity and ancient ideals. Schiller accused the philologists of tearing Homer's wreath. It was Goethe who, earlier himself a follower of Wolff's views of Homer, announced his apostasy in these verses: "As you are astute, you have freed us from all veneration, and we confessed overly freely that the Iliad was only a patchwork. May our rubbish offend no one, for youth knows how to ignite us, that we prefer to think of it as a whole, rather than joyfully feel it as a whole. For this lack of piety and admiration, it is believed, the reason must lie deeper, and many hesitate whether the philologists lack artistic skills and feelings at all, so that they are unable to do justice to the ideal, or whether it is in them spirit of negation, a destructive iconoclastic direction had become powerful. But if even the friends of antiquity with such misgivings, and if you doubt the overall character of the current classical philology as something quite questionable, what influence must the outbursts of the realist and the phrases of the heroes of the day have?" To answer the latter, and at this point, in view of the group of men gathered here, would be entirely inaccurate, if it is not to happen to me, like that sophist who in Sparta undertook to publicly praise and defend Heracles, but was interrupted by the cry, "Who has reprimanded him?" On the other hand, I cannot resist the thought that here and there, too, some of those concerns reverberate here and there, as they are often heard from the mouths of noble and artistically capable people. Yes, as an honest philologist really does not experience it most painfully in the dull moments of depressed mood. For the individual there is also no salvation at all from the dichotomy described above, but what we assert and hold up like a banner is the fact that classical philology as a whole has nothing to do with these struggles and troubles of its individual disciples. The entire scientific and artistic movement of this strange centaur is aiming with tremendous force, but cyclopean slowness, to bridge the gap between ideal antiquity, which is perhaps only the most beautiful flower of Germanic love longing for the South, and the real, and thus classical philology strives for nothing but the finite perfection of its own essence, complete coalescence and becoming one of the initially hostile and only forcibly brought together basic instincts. Even if one speaks of the inaccessibility of the goal, or even describes the goal itself as an illogical requirement, the striving, the movement towards that line is there, and I would like to try to use an example to make it clear how the most important steps of the classical philology never away from ideal antiquity, but lead towards it. And just as there, where one speaks abusively of the overthrow of the sanctuaries, only newer and more worthy altars have been built. Let us examine the so-called Homeric question from this standpoint, the same one of whose most important problem Schiller spoke as a learned barbarism. What is meant by this most important problem is the question of Homer's personality. One hears now everywhere the emphatic assertion that the question of Homer's personality is actually no longer up to date, and that it lies entirely apart from the real Homeric question. Now, of course, one can admit that for a given period of time, For example, for our philological present, the center of the question mentioned could be somewhat removed from the personality problem. It is precisely in the present day that one is making the most careful experiment of constructing Homeric poems without the actual help of personality, but as the work of many people. But if the center of a scientific question is rightly found there from where the full stream of new views has flowed, that is at the point in which individual scientific research comes into contact with the overall life of science and culture, that is if one designates the center according to a cultural historical value determination, then one has to stop in the area of Homeric research with the question of personality, as the actually fruitful core of a whole cycle of questions. In Homer, the modern world learned, I will not put it, a great historical point of view, but first tried it out, and without already giving my opinion here as to whether this test was made or could be made with luck on this particular object, the first example was given for the application of this fruitful point of view. Here one has learned to recognize condensed ideas in the apparently solid figures of older people's life, recognized the people's soul to pour states of morals and beliefs into the form of personality. Now that historical criticism has taken over the method with complete certainty of allowing apparently concrete personality to evaporate, it is permissible to designate the first experiment as an important event in the history of science, regardless of whether it succeeded in this case. It is the usual course that an epoch-making find is preceded by a series of conspicuous omens and preparatory individual observations. The aforementioned experiment also has an attractive prehistory, but at an astonishingly long distance in time. Friedrich August Wolff started exactly where Greek antiquity let the question fall out of the hands. The high point reached by the literary historical studies of the Greeks and thus also by the center of them, the Homer question, was the age of the great Alexandrian grammarians. Up to this climax, the Homeric question has run through the long chain of a uniform process of development, the last link of which, at the same time the last link that was at all accessible to antiquity, the standpoint of those grammarians. A Homer. They declared it to be psychologically possible that works of such different overall characters had sprung from one genius, in contrast to the horizons which signify the extreme skepticism of accidental individualities of antiquity, not antiquity itself. In order to explain the different total impressions of the two epics when assuming a poet, the ages were used as an aid, and the poet of the Odyssey was compared with the setting sun. For diversity of linguistic and intellectual expression, the eyes of those critics were of untiring sharpness and vigilance. At the same time, however, a history of Homeric poetry and its tradition had been made up, according to which these diversities were not Homer, but his editors and singers were a burden. It was thought that Homer's poems would be reproduced orally for a while and exposed to the rigors of improvising and sometimes forgetful singers. At a given point in time, in the time of Pisistratus, the orally surviving fragments should be collected in the books, but the editors were allowed to add dull and disturbing things to themselves. This whole hypothesis is the most important in the field of literary studies which antiquity has to show. In particular, the recognition of the oral dissemination of Homer, in contrast to the force of the habit of a book scholarly age, is an admirable climax of ancient science. From those times to those of Friedrich August Wolff, one has to make a leap through an immense vacuum. Beyond this limit, however, we find research exactly at the point at which antiquity had run out of strength to advance, and it is irrelevant that Wolff took as a short tradition what antiquity itself had put forward as a hypothesis. The characteristic of this hypothesis can be described as the fact that in the strictest sense the personality of Homer is to be taken seriously, that regularity and inner harmony in the expressions of personality are assumed everywhere, that with two excellent secondary hypotheses everything is wiped away as non-Homeric, that this regularity is reluctant. But this same basic trait of wanting to recognize a tangible personality in place of a supernatural being also goes through all those stages which lead to that climax, always with greater energy and growing conceptual clarity. The individual is felt and emphasized more and more, the psychological possibility for Homer more and more strongly challenged. If we go backwards step by step from that climax, we come across Aristotle's conception of the Homeric problem. For him, Homer is the flawless and infallible artist who is well aware of his ends and means, but in the naive devotion to popular opinion, which Homer also gave to the archetype of all comic epics that Margites attributed, still a point of view of immaturity in historical criticism. If we also go backwards from Aristotle, the inability to grasp a personality increases more and more. More and more poems are piled on the name of Homer, and each age shows its degree of criticism in how much and what it allows to stand as Homeric. In this slow step back, one senses involuntarily that beyond Herodotus lies a period in which an unmistakable flood of great epics was identified with the name of Homer. Let us put ourselves in the age of Pisistratus. At that time, the word Homer encompassed an abundance of the most disparate. What did Homer mean then? Obviously, that age felt incapable of scientifically encompassing a personality in the limits of its expressions. Homer had become almost an empty shell here. Here the important question arises: what lies ahead of this period? Has the personality of Homer, because it could not be grasped, gradually evaporated into an empty name? Or was the whole heroic poetry embodied in naive folk fashion at that time and illustrated under the figure of Homer? Has a concept been made out of a person, or a person out of a concept? This is the real Homeric question, that central personality problem. The difficulty of answering it increases, however, if one tries to answer from another angle, namely from the standpoint of the poems that have survived. How it is difficult nowadays and requires a serious effort to make the paradox of the law of gravitation clear, namely that the Earth changes its form of motion when another celestial body changes its position in space without there being a material bond between the two, so costs it is currently difficult to get the full impression of that wonderful problem which, wandering hand in hand, made its original highly conspicuous, has lost more and more stamps. Works of poetry, with which the greatest geniuses of courage sinks to compete, in which there are eternally unreached models for all artistic periods, and yet the poet of these is a hollow name, fragile where one touches him, nowhere the sure core of a ruling personality. For who dared to fight with gods, fight with one? Says Goethe himself, who, if any genius has struggled with that mysterious problem of Homer's inaccessibility. The concept of folk poetry seemed to go beyond the same ito lead as a bridge, a deeper and more primordial power than that of every single creative individual should have been active here, the happiest people in their happiest period, in the highest agility of imagination and poetic creative power, should have produced those immeasurable poems. In this generality, the idea of folk poetry has something intoxicating about it. One feels the broad, overpowering unleashing of a folk characteristic with artistic comfort and rejoices in this natural phenomenon as one rejoices in an inexorably flowing mass of water. But as soon as you wanted to approach this idea and see the face, so to put involuntarily in place of poetic folk soul, poetic folk crowd, a long line of folk poets in whom the individual meant nothing, but in whom the waves of the people's soul, the vivid power of the people's eye, the undiminished fullness of the people's imagination were powerful, a series of primitive geniuses, a time, a genre of poetry, one associated with substances. But such an idea rightly made one suspicious, should the same nature, which treats its rarest and the most delicious product, genius so sparingly and economically, have squandered in an inexplicable mood on just one point. Here the dubious question returned: it is not possible to get by with a single genius, and the existing did that unattainable excellence exist to explain? Now the view sharpened for that in which that excellence and singularity can be found. Impossible in the structure of the complete works, said one party, because this is deficient through and through, but certainly in the individual song, in the individual at all, not as a whole. On the other hand, another party asserted the authority of Aristotle, who most admired the divine nature of Homer precisely in the design and choice of the whole. If this draft did not emerge so clearly, it was a defect which was to be attributed to tradition, not to the poet, the consequence of revisions and insertions by which the original core was gradually veiled. The more the former direction towards bumps, she was looking for contradictions and confusions, the more decidedly the other threw away what she felt obscured the original plan, so that she might have the peeled Euripus in her hands. It was in the essence of the second direction that it clung to the concept of an epoch-making genius as the founder of great artistic epics. On the other hand, the other direction swayed back and forth between assumption of genius and a number of lesser revelers, and another hypothesis that it only requires a number of capable but mediocre singers' individualities, but presupposes a mysterious flow, a deep artistic national instinct that reveals itself in the individual singer as an almost indifferent medium. It is the consequence of this trend to present the incomparable advantages of Homeric poetry as the expression of that mysteriously flowing instinct. All these directions start from the assumption that the problem of the present existence of those epics can be solved from the standpoint of an aesthetic judgment. One expects the decision from the correct determination of the boundary line between the ingenious individual and the poetic folk soul. Are there characteristic differences between the expressions of the ingenious individual and the poetic folk soul? But this whole juxtaposition is unjustified and leads astray. This teaches the following consideration. There is no more dangerous opposition in modern aesthetics than that of folk poetry and individual poetry, or, as one is used to say, art poetry. This is the setback or, if you will, the superstition that the most momentous discovery of historical philological science brought about, the discovery and appreciation of the people's soul. With it the ground was created for a more or less scientific consideration of history, which until then and in many forms up to now had been a simple collection of material, with the prospect that this material would pile up indefinitely and that law and rule would never succeed to discover this ever new wave of waves. Now one understood for the first time the long-felt power of greater individualities and manifestations of will than the vanishing minimum of the individual human being. Now it was recognized how everything that was truly great and far-reaching in the realm of the will could not have its deepest root in the so short-lived and weak individual form of the will. Now at last one felt the great mass instincts, the unconscious national instincts as the actual carriers and levers of so-called world history. But the newly lit flame also cast its shadow, and this is precisely the superstition mentioned above which opposes folk poetry to individual poetry and in the most questionable way extends the vaguely defined concept of the people's soul to that of the people's spirit. By misusing a seductive conclusion based on the analogy, one had come to apply that principle of greater individuality to the realm of the intellect and artistic ideas, which has its value only in the realm of the will. The so ugly and unphilosophical masses have never been treated to anything more flattering than, and this is precisely the superstition referred to above, which opposes folk poetry to individual poetry and, in the most questionable way, extends the vaguely defined concept of the people's soul to that of the people's spirit. By misusing a seductive conclusion based on the analogy, one had come to apply that principle of greater individuality to the realm of the intellect and artistic ideas, which has its value only in the realm of the will. The so ugly and unphilosophical masses have never been treated to anything more flattering than, and this is precisely the superstition referred to above, which opposes folk poetry to individual poetry and, in the most questionable way, extends the vaguely defined concept of the people's soul to that of the people's spirit. By misusing a seductive conclusion based on the analogy, one had come to apply that principle of greater individuality to the realm of the intellect and artistic ideas, which has its value only in the realm of the will. The so ugly and unphilosophical masses have never been treated to anything more flattering than by misusing a seductive conclusion based on the analogy. One had come to apply that principle of greater individuality to the realm of the intellect and artistic ideas, which has its value only in the realm of the will. The so ugly and unphilosophical masses have never been treated to anything more flattering than by misusing a seductive conclusion based on the analogy. One had come to apply that principle of greater individuality to the realm of the intellect and artistic ideas, which has its value only in the realm of the will. The so ugly and unphilosophical masses have never been treated to anything more flattering than here, where the wreath of genius was placed on her bald head. One imagined that new barks were constantly growing around a small core, one thought that those mass seals were created in the same way as avalanches arise, namely in the course of the flow of tradition. But one was inclined to assume that small nucleus was as small as possible, so that one could occasionally account for it without losing anything of the total mass. This view is therefore exactly the same as what has been handed down and handed down. But in reality, such a contrast between folk poetry and individual poetry does not exist at all. Rather, all poetry and, of course, folk poetry as well, need a mediating individual. This mostly abusive juxtaposition only makes sense if by individual poetry one understands a poetry that did not grow on the basis of popular feeling, but goes back to an unpopular creator, and was produced in an unpopular atmosphere, for example in the scholar's study. The other is connected with the superstition, which assumes a poetic mass, that folk poetry is limited to a given period of time in every people and then dies out, as it is, however, in the consequence of that first superstition. According to this idea, art poetry, the work of individual heads, no longer whole masses, takes the place of this gradually dying folk poetry. But the same forces which were once active are still active now, and the form in which they work has remained exactly the same. The great poet of a literary age is still a folk poet, and in no sense less than any old folk poet was in an illiterate period. The only difference between the two concerns something completely different than the way in which their poems were created: tradition. This is in fact without the aid of captivating characters in Eternal exposed to the river and the danger to include foreign elements, remnants of those individualities in itself, by the way leads to the tradition. If we apply all these propositions to the Homeric poems, it turns out that we gain nothing with the theory of the poetic folk soul, that we are referred under all circumstances to the poetic individual. The task thus arises to grasp the individual and to distinguish it from that which has, to a certain extent, been washed ashore in the flow of the oral tradition, a component of Homeric poetry which is considered to be extremely considerable. Since the history of literature ceased to be or be allowed to be a register, attempts have been made to capture and formulate the individualities of the poets. The method involves a certain mechanism, it should be explained. It should consequently be deduced from reasons why this and that individuality shows itself in one way and not in another. Now one uses the biographical data, the environment, the acquaintances, the events of the time and believes to have brewed the required individuality from the mixture of all these ingredients. Unfortunately, one forgets that the moving point, the indefinable individuality, cannot be found out as a result. The less it is now clear about time and life, the less applicable is that mechanism. But if you only have the works and the name, then it is bad about the proof of individuality, at least for the friends of that mechanism mentioned, especially bad if the works are quite perfect, if they are folk poetry. For what those mechanics can first grasp the individual is the deviations from the genius of the people, the excesses and bent lines. Thus the less a poem has excesses, the paler the drawing of its individual poet will be. All those excesses, everything mat or mass lots, the one unexpected to find the Homeric poems, it was immediately ready to attribute the unfortunate tradition. What now remained as the individual Homeric? Nothing but a series of particularly beautiful and protruding areas selected according to subjective taste. The epitome of aesthetic singularity, which the individual recognized according to his artistic ability, he now called Homer. This is the center of Homeric errors. For the name Homer has from the beginning no necessary relation either to the concept of aesthetic perfection or to the Iliad and the Odyssey. Homer, as the poet of the Iliad and Odyssey, is not a historical tradition, but an aesthetic judgment. The only way that leads us back behind the time of Pisistratus and brings us forward through the meaning of the name Homer is on the one hand through the Homeric city tales, from which it is unequivocally evident how epic heroic poetry and Homer are everywhere identified, but nowhere he is in one in a different sense as a poet of the Iliad and Odyssey than, for example, the Thebaid or another cyclical epic. On the other hand, the ancient fable of a competition between Homer and Hesiod teaches that one senses two epic directions, the heroic and the didactic, when naming these names, that the meaning of Homer was thus placed in the material, not the formal. That fictitious competition with Hesiod does not even show a dim anticipation of the individual. But from the time of Pisistratus in the astonishingly rapid development of the Greek sense of beauty, the aesthetic differences in value of those epics were felt more and more clearly. The Iliad and the Odyssey emerged from the flood and since then have always remained on the surface. During this aesthetic process of elimination, the term Homer narrowed down more and more. The old material meaning of Homer the father of epic heroic poetry changed into the aesthetic meaning of Homer the father of poetry in general and at the same time their unreachable prototype. This transformation was accompanied by a rationalist criticism, which translated the miracle man Homer into a possible poet, who asserted the material and formal contradictions of those numerous epics against the unity of the poet and gradually took that heavy bundle of cyclical epics from Homer's shoulders. So Homer as the poet of the Iliad and Odyssey is an aesthetic judgment. However, this does not at all mean against the poet of the epics mentioned that he, too, is only an imagination, in truth an aesthetic impossibility, which will be the opinion of only a few philologists. Rather, most claim that the overall design of a poem like the Iliad includes an individual, and that is precisely what Homer is. The first will have to be admitted, but after what has been said I have to deny the second. I also doubt whether most of them came to accept the first point on the basis of the following consideration. The plan of such an epic as that of the Iliad is not a whole, not an organism, but a thread, a product of reflection proceeding according to aesthetic rules. It is certainly the measure of the size of an artist, how much he can overlook and rhythmically shape himself at the same time with an overall view. The infinite wealth of a Homeric epic in pictures and scenes makes such a total view impossible. However, where one cannot see artistically, one usually strings terms after terms and thinks up an arrangement according to a conceptual scheme. This will succeed all the more perfectly, the more consciously the arranging artist handles the basic aesthetic laws. Indeed, he himself will be able to arouse the deception as if the whole had floated in front of him as a vivid whole in a powerful moment. The Iliad is not a wreath, but a floral thread. As many pictures as possible are put in a frame, but the compiler was unconcerned whether the grouping of the compiled pictures was always a pleasant and rhythmically beautiful one. Because he knew that the whole thing was not an option for anyone, only the individual. That threading as the manifestation of an as yet underdeveloped, still less understood and generally valued understanding of art, but it cannot possibly have been the actual Homeric act, the epoch-making event. Rather, the plan is just the latest product and far younger than Homer's celebrity. So those who are looking for the original and perfect plan are looking for a phantom. For the dangerous path of oral tradition was just completed when the plan was added. The blemishes which that path brought with it cannot have hit the plan that was not included in the traditional mass. The relative imperfection of the plan, however, must by no means be asserted in order to represent in the plan maker a personality different from the actual poet. It is not only likely that everything that was created with conscious aesthetic insight in those times was infinitely inferior to the songs that burst forth with instinctive power. Yes, you can go one step further. If one uses the great so-called cyclical poems for comparison, the plan maker of the Iliad and Odyssey has the undeniable merit of having achieved the relatively highest in this conscious technique of composing. A merit which we should be inclined from the outset to recognize in what counts to us as the first in the realm of instinctive creation. Perhaps one will even welcome a far-reaching hint in this connection. All those weaknesses and damages that are considered to be so significant, but on the whole highly subjective, which one is accustomed to looking like the petrified remains of the traditional period, are they not perhaps only the almost necessary evils for which the ingenious poet intended so magnificently, almost unprecedented and had to fall victim to the unpredictably difficult composing of the whole thing? One notices that the insight into the quite different workshops of the instinctive and the conscious also shifts the question of a Homeric problem, and, I think, towards the light. We believe in the one great poet of the Iliad and Odyssey, but not in Homer as this poet. The decision on this has already been made. The age that invented the innumerable Homer's fables, that composed the myth of the Homeric Hesiodic competition, that regarded all of Cyclo's poems as Homeric, felt it was not an aesthetic but a material singularity when it uttered the name Homer. For this age Homer belongs to the series of stage names such as Orpheus, Eumolpus, Daedalus, Olympus, to the series of mythical discoverers of a new branch of art, to whom all later fruits that grew on the new branch were gratefully dedicated. And indeed that most wonderful genius, to whom we owe the Iliad and Odyssey, also belongs to this grateful posterity. He also sacrificed his name on the altar of the ancient father of the epic heroic poetry, Homer. Up to this point and in strict keeping away from all details, I thought to you, dearest present, to present the philosophical and aesthetic basic features of the Homeric personality problem, on the assumption that the basic formations of that widely ramified and deeply fissured mountain, which is called the Homeric question, is known to be shown most sharply and clearly at as great a distance as possible and from a height. At the same time, however, I imagine that I have used an example to bring two facts to mind to those friends of antiquity who so like to accuse us philologists of lack of piety to great concepts and an unproductive lust for destruction. First of all, those big terms such as one and the inviolable undivided poetic genius Homer in the pre-Wolf's term, actually fragile, just too great and therefore internally very empty and coarse as you fasten terms. When classical philology now comes back to the same concepts, it is only apparently the old dupes. In truth everything has become new, hose and spirit, wine and word. You can feel it everywhere that philologists have lived with poets, thinkers and artists for almost a century. Hence it is that that hill of ashes and cinder, which was formerly known as classical antiquity, has now become fertile, indeed lush, arable land. And a second thing I would like to appeal to those friends of antiquity who turn away from classical philology with displeasure. You adore the immortal masterpieces of the Hellenic spirit in words and images and imagine yourself to be much richer and happier than any generation that had to do without them. Well, do not forget that this whole magical world was once buried, showered with mountain-high prejudices. Do not forget that blood and sweat and the most arduous thought work of countless disciples of our science were necessary to make that world rise from its oblivion. Philology is not the creator of that world, it is not the tone poet of this immortal music, but it shouldn't be a merit and a big one. Let them, who lay undeciphered and undervalued in the corner for so long. Who was Homer before Wolf's courageous mental act? A good old age, at best known as a natural genius, at least the child of a barbaric age, full of offences against good taste and morality. We hear but as yet in an excellent scholar Homer writes, where but love keeps man on. Why did he stay incognito for so long? Speaking of which, don't you know how to get me a silhouette of him? We demand gratitude, by no means in our name, because we are atoms but in the name of philology itself, which is neither a muse nor a grace, but a messenger of the gods. And as the Muses descended to the dreary, troubled Boeotian peasants, so she comes into a world full of gloomy colors and images, full of the deepest and the most incurable pains, and tells comfortingly of the beautiful, bright gods of a distant, blue, happy magical land. So much. And yet a few more words must be said, and of the most personal kind at that. But the reason for this speech will justify me. It is also up to a philologist to express the goal of his striving and the way there into the short formula of a creed, and so let this be done by reversing a sentence of Seneca: philosophy has become what was philology. This is to say that all and every philological activity is to be enclosed and bounded by a philosophical worldview in which everything individual and isolated evaporates as something reprehensible and only the whole and uniform remains. And so let me hope that with this direction I will not be a stranger among you. Give me the confidence that, by working with you in this spirit, I will be able to, in particular, the excellent trust that the high ones give me authorities of this community have proven, to conform in a dignified manner.